Live na to, bro.
Yes, bro, we are live. However, hindi pa tayo nakikita ng mga tao.
Okay.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to a special edition of Agri Ka Ba? Marahil nagtataka kayo kung bakit kami live at this hour. We're usually live gabi. Pero we had to do this. We have very, very special guests. Ayan, magpapakita na ako sa inyo. Hello, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the stream. Tataka kayo, bakit napakaliit ni Dax, nandun lang siya sa corner at nag-iisa siya. Huwag kayo mag-alala, meron tayong mga kasama dito. Jim, pakita ka nga. Ayan, kita ka na, bro.
Kita na ba?
Yes, yes.
Baka makikita dito sa
iba. Makikita mo dyan mga after 10 seconds.
Okay.
Okay, bro, so you can...
Good morning. Very good morning. Not the usual good evening to our viewers and guests. This is Agri Ka Ba in the morning because we have very special guests. And it's very interesting because we rarely have the chance to, you know, dive into a narrative about their journeys or anything about their narrative, but the journeys behind the scenes, behind the, you know, the what people see on the successes or the achievements that that are being posted. So this is a look and a glimpse into the lives behind and the journey behind. So very interesting to. Pasok natin si Bards.
Teka lang. Justin? Bards, gusto mo na bang pumasok? Pasok.
Hello. Hello, good morning. Okay na, ano dyan na ba?
Nandito ka na. Kita na kita. Kita na kita.
Lahat po na nanonood. Ngayong umaga, yun nga, nabanggit nga ni Daxet Jim that this is a very special day for all of us. And again, this is Agri Ka Ba, powered by Dream Agri Media and Young Professionals for Agricultural Development.
Yun! Sakto, white part for
yes, me. Tama.
Nakakalimutan. Huwag nyo kalimutan yun.
And yes.
And today, we have guests from one of the supporters, one of the ardent supporters of YPARD. And I think, Jim, member ka rin ng grupo na ito.
Yes. So, we have the chairman and the president of the Coalition for Agriculture Modernization in Philippines, or CAMP. And tayo po ay isa sa mga pinakaunang mga young people na nakasama at nagka-rub elbows with the top-notch people in Philippine agriculture. No? So let's not waste time. And this is going to be different because instead of us introducing them, we will bring them to the screen and they will introduce themselves just like what they do in their camp meeting.
Although, to be clear, they really don't need to introduce themselves.
Parang actually,
their names alone, they need no introduction. But for the sake nung mga hindi pa sila masyadong kilala at para dun sa mas gusto pa silang makilala, sakto kasi nanood kayo ngayon ng Agri Ka Ba. So ngayon, I will bring our two guests onto the stage. It is my honor to bring onto the stage Dr. Emil Abier and Dr. Ben Pexon. And now we are all live. Welcome, welcome, yes. Sirs. Welcome to the stream.
Magandang umaga, Dax. Jim and Justin at ang mga manonood natin.
Ayan sir, medyo marami na pong pumapasok sa stream natin ngayon and I really thought that this would be a tape affair kasi we were trying to work out our technical side, but we are fortunate na ngayon we are on live and this will be replayed pala for those in the audience. This will be replayed at 7:30 PM later tonight para doon naman sa mga after work special. So, para hindi kayo mag-miss out. So, sino pong gustong mauna? Sir Ben? Sir Emil? Sir Emil.
Okay. Sige, magpapakilala muna kami, di ba?
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sige. Dax, mayroong dahilan bakit morning instead na gabi. Kasi kami yung mga senior citizen, mga early risers kami, morning people kami. Hindi kami evening people ni Ben. So may dahilan.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So ako si Emil Javier. Ako ay tubong Santa Cruz, Laguna.
Woo!
Yes!
graduate ng Pedro Guevara Memorial High School. Ako ay nagtapos dito sa College of Agriculture sa larangan ng agronomy at plant breeding. Ang mga napasukan ko, ako ang nagtatag ng Institute of Plant Breeding at saka yung Biotech Institute dito sa Los Baños. Later on, naswerte tayo, naging chancellor ako, naging UP president at saka Minister of Science noong panahon ni President Marcos. Yan ang aking istorya sa agriculture.
Okay, sir. So,
and sir, you were conferred last year po, tama? Na you are now conferred as a national scientist by DOST NAS.
Ayun ah, eh, mga dekorasyon na lang 'yon, mga dekorasyon.
Dekorasyon.
Okay. Grabe si sir, so super humble.
All right.
So, ngayon naman, we will hear from the president of the Coalition for Agricultural Modernization of the Philippines, Dr. Ben Pexon. Sir Ben, as an industry man, can you tell us your story naman po?
But anyway, from my bachelor's degree in sugar tech, I obtained a PhD in chemistry, major in physical chemistry from Purdue. And then I did a postdoc at Oklahoma State University. From there, I became a principal investigator at the iResearch Institute in Boston. That's part of the Harvard Medical School with a big report on diabetes. I returned as a balik scientist and worked for United Laboratories. Kaya nakikita niyo yung mga advertisement, ano? Sabi niya, Unilab ito. I was part of the team to make sure that our Unilab products are as good as or better than the innovator products. Wow. So I spent a lot of time at Unilab, and but then I went back to agriculture. 10 years before retirement, I started my career in how to go back to agriculture. Because if you work in industry for a long time, you want to have no more bosses. By the way, when I was working in Boston, I had no boss. For 10 years, I was doing my own research, pursuing my own ideas, and I was lucky enough that I was able to keep on renewing my my grant there. After a while, I figured, hey, it's time to go back to the grant. So I'm one of the public scientists. Mm. Anyway, I'm back to agriculture, and I bring in both. Let's go.
Yun. Grabe. So, kasi kung babasahin namin or kung maghahanap kami ng articles about you guys, baka yung buong dalawang oras ng show, hindi pa kami tapos na mag-introduce. So kung isasama natin lahat ng papers na pinublish nyo, lahat ng articles na sinulat nyo. By the way, speaking of articles, Dr. Emil writes an article for a newspaper, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Sir Emil, saan namin may kita mga articles?
Yeah. In ang column ko ay why not
mm-hmm. Which yes. Tama po, ano pong newspaper ito, sir?
Bulletin, so Manila Sunday bulletin. Sunday bulletin, Manila Bulletin.
All right, so okay, I guess ayan, mayroong mga bumabati sa atin. Good morning sa mga taga Dream Agritech watching from Olongapo City. Good morning po sa inyo. Para po sa mga nanonood, please do comment kung saan po kayo nanonood ngayon para po mabati po namin kayo sa ngayong umaga na ito.
Yeah. And of course, if you have questions for our special guests today.
Esteemed
guests today.
Yes.
Fire away.
Ito na ang pagkakataon yung magtanong. Huwag may hiyang magtanong. Okay, sir. Okay, so I guess we'll start off with one big question. everybody started somewhere. So, initially, ano po yung impressions nyo on agriculture before you entered college, or was it your first choice, or was it something that you really wanted to pursue? I guess we'll start with Doc Emil.
Ah, hindi. Wala akong pakialam sa agriculture noon. Kasi nung ako ay nasa high school, mahilig ako sa history, lalo na yung military history. Mm. At saka yung panahon ng Korean War. So ang aking fantasy, maging military general, parang si Patton, si Guderian. Yun ang aking fantasy.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Pero ang problema, to get to PMA, I must satisfy 3 requirements. Unang-una, you have to be 18 years old. Eh, 15 and a half lang ako noon. Gumraduate sa Gibara. Tapos, wow, you must be 5 feet 4 inches.
Okay.
Eh, katulad ni Jim, 4'11 lang ako noon eh. 4'11. Eh, tapos, you must be 120 pounds. Eh, ako eh, less than 100 pounds. So, wala na akong choice, wala na akong chance makapasok sa PMA. So, pinakamalapit, Los Baños.
Mm-hmm.
At saka, kasi free tuition naman ako, kasi hindi pagayabang, valedictorian ako sa Gibara, at least free tuition. Pero ang problema, ang tatay ko ay laborer sa public works. Ang tawag nung araw, mga kaminero. Ang nanay ko naman, sa bahay. So, hindi ako pwedeng mag-aral sa Maynila.
Mm-hmm.
Ang chance ko lang, sa agriculture ako mag-aral sa Los Baños. Swerte naman, ako ay na-introduce kay Dean Umali. So, mahabang istorya yan. Mm-hmm. So, yun ang simula. Hindi ko choice ang agriculture. Wala lang akong pupuntahan. Ang pinakamalapit sa Santa Cruz ay Los Baños.
Mm-hmm.
Kaya dito ako napadpad. At sinuwerte naman ako, napakilala ako kay Dean Umali. So, mahabang story yan, pero I'll leave it at that. Yun ang aking storya para paano ako na pinunta sa agriculture.
Wow. Astig, you know, the building, DL, hanggang DL Umali building lang po yung
DL Umali
alam building. Ko, sir, eh. Pero kayo, nakilala niyo po talaga si Dean Umali.
The man himself. Harry,
the man himself.
All right.
Amazing.
Okay. I'm also very excited to hear from Dr. Ben. Dr. Ben, paano po ba kayo napunta sa pagiging scientist, chemist? Was it also your first choice?
Actually, it was my first choice. In high school, my vocational was poultry science, and I enjoyed it. So, I told my mom I wanted to enroll at Los Baños. Sabi niya, wala naman tayong lupa. Bakit ka pupunta niyan? Sabi ko, I think I enjoy it. So, she's a wise mother and still let me go there. But like I was saying earlier, my career actually did not involve agriculture. Yung una, I was a physical chemist. I was studying rapid reactions, fast reactions, enzymes, membranes, and so on. And then my career at United Laboratories was so my career was really in science and in manufacturing. So I guess I will be coming more from industry. But 10 years before retirement, I wanted to be independent. Kasawa na akong merong boss. I wanted to strike out on my own. So I, at that point, 10 years before retirement, I planted more than 1,000 mango trees. Then I dug up part of the farm. 1.5 hectares. I place tilapia. I did a lot of other things with a friend of mine, a sugar tech. We made the organic fertilizer from Tiltal Press Cake. And then I started planting onions. I rented 16 hectares in Nueva Ecija, planted it to onions. And pwede, kikita yun. Pwede ang onions. So mm-hmm. I got involved in agriculture. Maraming kamukha ko na after retirement, they want to go into agriculture. And we are not really, maraming very successful entrepreneurs, they go after retirement. So anyway, from there, I got involved in biotechnology.
Mm-hmm.
And although a lot of people have difficulty with biotechnology, as a scientist, I realize it will be an enabler. I'll talk more about that later. If we have to feed the world, we need biotechnology, but we have to convince yung mga people who are concerned about it that it's safe. And it will be one of the technologies which will save us. So there we go. From a science back to agriculture, because I really like it. And I think you can make money out of it if you're smart. And you're, if you're there, kailangan nandun ka. Ang pinakamalaki mong investment siguro, if you're in agriculture, ang bakas mo. Kung wala ka doon, mahirapan ka.
Tama yan, sir. Tama yan, sir. And being, having managed a farm, also managing our own farms. Tama, sir. I also advise our clients po lagi dito sa aming, sa maliit naming consultancy ni na Jim na, ano yung time commitment niyo dun sa farm? I mean, will you be there every week? Will you, how many days in a month will you be there? Kasi hindi pwedeng remote control farming ito. Kailangan, you must be there. Kahit na hindi kayo yung mismong nagdudukal or kayo mismo yung nagwi-weed, basta nandun kayo kasi para nakikita nyo yung developments. So, grabe, first question pa lang. I am shocked already na yun pala, man. Si Doc Emil wanted to be a soldier. And si... grabe yun. Because...
Interesting, no? Kasi si Doc Emil gusto mag-history. At the time when Doc Emil was UP president, yung eldest sister ko was studying history in UP Diliman. Wala lang.
Na-connect ko lang. Pero I think that was a comment. Ayan, wow, history. Dr. Javier was the UP president during my undergrad. One comment yan dito sa stream. So
ayun, the yun yung sister ko.
Ah, that was, hello po ate, hello. Sakto. Sakto po yung comment.
Doc Emil, paki-unmute po yung sarili niya sa...
Yes, please. Wait lang. I think I can unmute him from here. Ask to unmute.
Doc Emil, pa-unmute po ng ano? Ng account. Yun, okay na po.
Ayan, Doc. So, ayun po, no, very surprising na Doc Emil wanted to be a soldier. Si Doc Ben naman went around the world. So, he was able to experience industry and then he went back to
balik scientist.
Balik magsasaka. So, grabe.
Ngayon, I will insert ngayon.
Go ahead.
Yung ambition kung maging general, I succeeded vicariously through my younger brother.
Oh.
Kasi yung younger brother ko, graduate din ng Gibara, I pushed him and he graduated from West Point. He retired Major General from the Constab Villari. So, meron din kaming military yung naging general sa family namin. Pero hindi ako. Kasi yung younger brother ko, si General Eric, was studying here in Los Baños in Ag Engineering.
Okay.
Merong announcement ang civil service for West Point. So, I pushed him. Tingnan ko nga kung magaling ka. You take the exam. And he succeeded. So, from Ag Engineering, he became a West Point
graduate.
Wow. So, vicariously, natupad ko rin yung ambisyon ko through my younger brother.
Naging consultant na po kayo to, General, sir.
pero ang irony ngayon, yung brother ko, very active siya sa farming.
Ayan.
Meron siyang 2-hectare fruit farm. Siya ngayon ang agriculturist.
Hindi, sir, interesting yun. That pala may follow-up interview kay Major Eric po. Eric is your brother's name.
Eric, si General Eric.
That pala tanongin, yung pagiging general po ba, first choice nyo rin po ba yan? Tapos, actually, pinilit lang ako ng kuya ko, ng kapatid ko eh. Hinamon niya ako eh, na-challenge ako.
Challenge accepted.
Challenge accepted, I became a general. Grabe yan, wow. We are learning a lot.
Nice.
Grabe, first question pa lang, ang dami ng kwento. So this is exactly what this show is all about.
Yes, maganda talaga. You know, I just want to re-emphasize with our viewers na that this is very, this is privileged somehow information or at least time to unpack the stories behind the scenes. Kasi, I mean, ako, 5 years na akong nasa camp, no? Pero we can't talk about, you know, we don't normally go and dive into the stories behind. Pero ito, maganda. We were getting to know our national scientist, the president of camp. We're getting to know the reasons behind how they joined or found their way into the agriculture career. So, masaya, masaya usapan to. All right.
Okay, so I think bigyan naman
si Bards.
Natin. Si Bards naman
ang tanong si Bards.
Yung oh, Bards, baka may tanong ka or gusto mo nang itanong yung ating we'll dive right in. Bards, are you there? Nag-freeze ka ba? I think nag-freeze siya.
Nag-freeze si Bards.
Bards, steady ka lang diyan. Pipicture lang ka namin. Okay. All right. Jim.
Nasa iyo yung questions, bro.
All right.
Shoot away na lang. Yes.
Sige, sige. But I think yung para dun sa audiences natin, I would just like to remind you that you can ask your questions while we habang nandito tayo sa show, habang nandito ang dalawang haligi ng ating industriya, si Doc Ben at si Doc Emil. Magtanong na kayo, pagkakataon nyo na to. Kaya guys, please don't hesitate to leave a comment on our comment section, lalo na para sa mga nanonood sa atin ng live ngayon. And I'm just trying to pull up yung file natin. Wait lang, ito na, ito na.
Yeah. Pero I think maybe since we got to talk about how they got back to the into the
yes.
agriculture for Sir Ben and si Doc Emil, how he found his way into UPLB. I think the question now would be, I mean, just following that progression of the storyline. What was your first job, maybe, sirs? After you graduated in these these programs related to agriculture, what was your first job? How did you get into it?
Yon.
Sige, ako ang sasagot muna, Ben. I will be the first one. Ang boss na noon si Dr. Umali. For people who graduated from UP Los Baños, kilala natin si Dr. Umali kasi talagang siya ang nagtaguyod ng UP Los Baños to where it is now. Si Dr. Umali ay plant breeder. So isa ako dun sa mga young people na na-recruit ni Dean Umali to major in plant breeding. At yun ang pinakamahalagang yugto sa aking buhay at that point kasi as a student assistant, I was able to finish college on my own. Kasi noong mga panahon na yon, eh, pwede kang magtrabaho as student assistant sa UP and you get 50 centavos per hour. So ang sweldo mo, wow. Maximum of 100 hours, 50 pesos. Pero kung matipid ka, buhay ka na noon eh.
Sir,
so I was able to complete college on the a student assistant in plant breeding under Dr. Malik.
Sir, for context lang po, yung 50 centavos, ano pong mabibili nun during your time?
50 centavos per hour.
Okay. Opo, ano pong purchasing power nun? Ano pong makakabili na po ba kayo ng food nun? Or ano pong
pwede? Kung kakain ka ng lunch sa Grove, eh kailangan mo mga 20-25 centavos. Nakatanghalian ka na.
Busog na pala sa 50 cents po.
Ngayon, okay. Ang unang trabaho ko sa plant breeding kay Dr. Umal, eh pinapunta ako sa Bicol at sa Mindanao hanggang Siasi, Bongao, Lolo, mangulek ng coconut varieties. Pero yung aking trabaho sa Bicol, eh maghanap ng survivors ng kadang-kadang kasi noon na naatake ng kadang-kadang virus disease ang coconut sa Bicol. Yeah. Ang sabi ni Dr. Malis sa akin, magpasyal ka sa Bicol, hanapin mo yung mga survivor palm trees, kuha mo ng seeds, dali mo sa Pili School, tingnan natin baka merong resistance. Pero yung coconut collection, nakaabot ako ng Bongao, Siasi, all over the country. Pero kalimit, wow. afternoon sa Bicol. Pagkatapos, noon, yung mga abaka natin, may sakit din, yung Banchitang hanggang ngayon.
Yes.
So, yun ang dalawang trabaho ko. Maghanap ng surviving abaka plants sa Bicol, San Miguel Island, sa Tabaco, all over. And then find out kung merong resistance yung survivor. Mm-hmm. Ang problema, I did that for 2 years from 60 to 62 until I went abroad. Ang problema, lahat ng nakolect ko nagkasakit. Mga escape lang pala yon, walang genes for resistance ako nahanap. Mga escape lamang yun nakuha kong coconut at abaka na nakolect ko for 2 years. So yun ang simula ko. Simula ko, failure agad.
2 years kayong nag-collect, sir, and ganun yung nangyari?
Oo.
Oh. Wow.
Woo. 2 years of your life.
Anong naging...
How did you feel about it, sir?
How did you feel about it? Anong...
But you see, about 50 years later, sa Institute of Plant Breeding, our young people... yung mga successor generation namin nila Dr. Villarreal, kasi pagkatapos ko si Dr. Villarreal naman yung trabaho ko, nagsucceed naman yung mga young people natin sa plant breeding. Meron na silang virus resistant variety of abaka.
Opo.
Yun ay mga advanced generation ng hybrid between abaka and pakol, which is a native banana na resistant. Pero nung panahon namin ni Dr. Villarreal, hanggang F1 hybrid lang kami. And then we have, merong sterility barrier na hindi namin na-solve. So, we did not succeed. Pero yung mga succeeding generations namin, ngayon, sila Tony Lalikan, si Dr. Lalikan, meron ng variety ngayon na abaka na Plant Breeding Institute is promoting. Talagang resistant to the viruses. At the same time, with very good abaka pulp properties.
Mm-hmm. Yun po yung kila Dr. Lalusin ngayon.
Sila Tony Lalusin.
Yes po.
So yan ang story ng science. Mahabang salaysayin. But in the end, progress is made.
Yes. Wow. Ganda. Yun. So para sa mga viewers, yung mga young people na nanonood, don't be disheartened, no? Mm-hmm. If you encounter failures, kahit ganyan ang mangyari sa 2 years mong trinabaho, you can still reap benefits from it.
You can still become a national scientist.
Yes!
Huwag kayong mag-alala. Actually, sir, maganda yun, ano? Kasi parang siguro, kasi yung mga tao, ina-assume nila national scientist. So from the get-go, excellence ka agad.
Successful na agad.
Parang sunod-sunod na excellence. Parang akala yata nila yung ladder to the top, straight lang na ganyan. Pero meron palang mga detours yan. So, it is actually encouraging, no, na parang marinig na kahit pala national scientist ka, you still experience these things.
Yeah. And, hindi resistant to failure.
Ang story, ang science, you build upon the achievements of the people before you.
Mm-hmm.
So yung sila Lalusin, sila Dr. Lalusin ng IPB ngayon, they succeeded kasi sinimulan niya ni Dr. Umali, ni Dr. Bernardo, Dr. Ramirez, pagkatapos ako, si Dr. Villarreal. Marami kaming nagtrabaho dyan. Umabot ng almost 60 years of effort. Then finally, success.
Yeah.
So mahaba pa, mahaba istorya.
Say something about yung origins. So when I was, like Emil, I was a student assistant. Making a month, I was handling laboratories. But when I was 16 years old, I worked for one summer in an airfield in Zambales. I was putting up a barbed wire with 2 other guys. I lived there on very, very frugally. So, nung pag-graduate ko, I really wanted to get out of the Philippines. To the point, like kamukha ni Emil, I wanted to join the French Foreign Legion.
Mm. Legionnaire.
Yeah.
Legionnaire.
Legionnaire, because I had a guy in the dormitory who was a legionnaire. And well, yeah, puta ka na, para. Grabe yung legionnaires. But fortunately, I was able to get a assistant seat from a professor. Pero before that, hindi ako makakuha ng scholarship sa UP because may nakaaway akong professor. And siningko niya ako 18 units. That's a whole semester. Equivalent of 6.
Dismissed po yata yun, sir.
Nakaaway ko sa professor. Singko ako. So, mahirap ako makakuha ng
scholarship.
Scholarship.
Okay.
Fortunately, luck, luck sa buhay. There was this guy who was a professor at Texas A&M. And meron siyang estudyante in Pilipina. And she did very well. So the guy offered me a fellowship. And I went to Texas A&M. And when he moved to Purdue, I followed him. He went to Iowa, I followed him also. And he was my mentor until he died. And I was a postdoc and I was already working. He was also giving me advice. But then, anyway, I want to say na kahit na nakaaway kong professor, I was able to overcome that. But I want to say something about yung heading bosses. One of the problem, I don't know how many people love their bosses, but I think a lot of people are unhappy with their bosses. When I was working at Unilab, my immediate boss was a traditionalist. Gusto niya nag-micromanage. Ako naman, I had faith in my people. So, I didn't want to do overtime on my part just to watch them because they're professionals. So, they can do their jobs well. Anyway, so iba. Nag-aaway kami talaga nung major boss ko. Anong major boss ko. But then, there came a time when promotions were made. There are steps there. And one time I was announced at a meeting that I'll be an assistant vice president. Paling sa akin yung boss ko sa ganyan. I did not recommend you. Sabi niyo sa akin. blurted out. Hindi niya ako recommend. But what I'm saying is, if you perform well enough, even if your immediate boss does not like you, other people see the value of what you're doing. So may mga ganyang suliranin. And okay. At the end of the day, you do okay if you persevere with your ideas.
Okay. So ang moral of the story, you select your boss, ha?
Yes, so wait, first, that's why I wanted to leave na eh. I was frustrated having a boss.
Okay. Pero in my case, I was very lucky kasi ang naging boss ko si Dr. Joscoro O'Malley, who was very nurturing.
Yeah.
Pero hindi lang ako, marami kami. Si Dr. Nanding Bernardo, for people in Los Baños, kilala niyo si Dr. Bernardo. Si National Science. Oh, pinsan ko yun. Si National Scientist Dolores Ramirez, yes. National Scientist Rick Lantican, si Dr. Villarreal, Dr. Carpena. Marami kami kasi Dr. O'Malley selected students who were in the honor roll sa Los Baños. Mm-hmm. Dalawang requirement niya, kailangan nandun ka sa honor roll sa college at saka kailangan mahirap ka, you come from a poor family. So we were recruited on that basis. And Dr. O'Malley was a very nurturing boss and he made sure that we did very well. Kaya yung Institute of Plant Breeding, which I established, was really premised on the goodness and nurturing of Dr. O'Malley. Yun ang boss ko. So, in that sense, I got started quite well because of the fortune of having a very, very good boss. Mm. Pero unlike Ben, maswerte ako sa boss kasi later on, naging boss ko si Marcos.
I want to say something more about having a boss. When I worked at the Eye Research Institute of Boston for about 10 years, I had no boss. I was getting grants from the NIH, so I just pursued my ideas. And I loved that portion of my life. Anyway, I want to connect that with agriculture. if you become an entrepreneur in agriculture, wala kang boss. Your boss is the public. And I want to tell young people, when you are an entrepreneur, you have no direct boss. As long as you have a venture, you will put a team. You can succeed without getting an immediate. Your boss is the market. And if you're smart, I think that Emil will agree with me that if you're smart, you can succeed in agriculture and you can make good money. With the right mindset, with the right competence, if you're a risk taker, and if you know what you want to do.
Yeah.
In fact, the Secretary Yap na agriculture, he wrote a booklet, 100 plus ventures you could do on your own. And wala kang boss, that's the best part.
Pero sir, maganda yung, I think I like that point very much na, oo, wala kang boss as an entrepreneur, but your boss is actually the public. And yes. Once you see a need and you feel that need, you are fulfilling your mandate. You are actually serving your bosses, which is not just one person, but a whole industry waiting for your services.
Para dun sa napaka UP, no?
serve the people. Yes. Pero yes. Grabe, no? Yung kanina, nung pinapakinggo si Doc Emil na parang, para dun sa mga nanonood pala na bata ngayon, ano, yung mga familiar sa Avengers. So narinig ko kanina, sabi ni Doc Emil, binuo kami ni Dr. Umali, si Dr. Ramirez, si Dr. Villarreal.
Avengers ako, Assemble.
Yun pala ang kauna-unahang Avengers. So guys, yung mga Stan Lee, ha? Nangopya ka lang. Inopya mo lang si Dr. Umali, nauna siya. Siya ang unang bumuo ng Avengers ng agriculture.
Yes, okay? Yes.
Ayan. Pero
hindi, ang maganda si ang nakita ko, no, na nadala ni Dr. Umali yung pagiging plant breeder niya sa pag-mentor ng tao kasi yeah, nag-selection process and then may nurturing, 'di ba? So
may hybrid vigor.
May hybrid vigor. may heterosis.
Yes. Pero sir, ayun po, ano, I think Dr. Emil had DL Umali as a mentor and Doc Ben also had a mentor which he followed around. So how para sa aming mga kabataan, how can you put it into context how important it is to have a mentor or how important it is to have someone you can ano, I think una po Doc Emil, yes. Can you
share? Yung pagkaroon mo ng mentor, yun in a way is a luck of the draw. Yeah, hindi ko naman kilala si Dr. Umali, napadpad lang ako sa Los Baños and then I got introduced to him. But in the end, it's really for you as an individual to have a clear idea of what you want to do with your life. Dapat maliwanag sa'yo anong gusto mo mangyari sa buhay mo. And as you go along, then you take advantage of whatever life offers you. So yun ang istorya, and whatever you do, you try the best that you can, and you have to think. And sa akin, ang aking formula, I read a lot, kasi yung story ng civilization nasulat na yan eh. So why repeat the errors of the past? You can avoid the errors of the past by reading the history of people. Kaya ang aking unang fascination was history.
Yeah.
So kailangan basa ka ng basa, because by reading the lives of other people, you will know how they treated the opportunities and challenges that came your way. And from there, you could draw your own conclusions how you would do the same. So yung fascination ko for history, it translated to reading. Yun ang lagi ko sinasabi sa mga kabataan. Kailangan magbasa kayo. Kasi kung may problema ka ngayon, hindi naman ikaw ang kauna-unahang tao ko sa mundo nagkaroon ng problema na yan eh.
Actually.
Marami na nagkaroon ng problema at marami na sulat na. Of course, iba yung situation nila, iba ang situation mo. Pero from their life story, you can learn. So yun ang aking message.
Okay,
you must have a good idea of what you want to do with your life. And then fortify yourself with knowledge of civilization by reading and reading and reading. Lalo na sa science, kailangan lagi ka nagbabasa.
Mag-review talaga ng literature po.
What I think about this.
Yes, Doc.
I had that major professor who was an incredible mentor for me from graduate school until I was already in my professional. But along the way, I met a lot of other mentors. So like postdoc ako, I had a guy who was a Harvard graduate and then postdoc from MIT. From him I learned you have to really work very hard and you have to be good. And then I had another mentor who was basically just my age. He was a professor of Oklahoma State University. Actually, I shifted work because I met the guy. Nagtadilan kami sa aeroplano, a 3-hour flight. By the time I got out of the airplane, I had a new job and I had a new mentor. Yeah. And then when I was working in industry na, there was this professor from the University of Illinois at Chicago. And it so happened, he was an Upsilonian, so magpadali kami mag-usap. Member din ako ng Upsilonian. So anyway, throughout life, I looked for mentors. I made a conscious effort to look for mentors. I tended to associate with older guys. Ang thinking ko kasi, older guys will have more experience. And I look for older guys who are achievers. So I try to surround myself with people who have more experience than me and who are smarter than me. Important yun, you surround yourself with good people na mas mahusay sa'yo. Anyway, the other end of the story, you have to be a mentor naman for other people. You have to help the younger people. So I got something, a lot, from my mentors. At the same time, I endeavored to be a mentor to some people. And I loved it when I umalis na ako sa work ko. Even now, people in my group said they called me their mentor, and I really, really feel good about it that they felt that I was a positive influence in their life. Sabi nila, you taught us to speak out. Yun ang isang problema ng mga Filipino students. I don't know about now, but during my time in college, kimi ang mga Filipino eh. By contrast, I remember one time when I was in the States, may sasalita yung professor, sabi ng estudyante, sir, you're wrong. I loved it. So anyway, yung mga tawang ko in my group, I told them to speak out. And one of them said, you know, gusto ko sa'yo, sabi niya, I can contradict you in a meeting if you never punish me. Let ideas flow. We get the best ideas. I don't care what your background is. I want to know your idea. Important yan. You have to give your subordinate a venue that they can express themselves. Anyway, find a mentor, and then you yourself
share. Be a mentor.
With younger people.
Yeah. Ganda. Very nice po. Thank you. These are not just gold nuggets po. I feel like these are gold bars. Hindi lang po siya nuggets of wisdom, bars of wisdom
these
po
bars.
Ito.
They're printing out bars.
And actually, bro, Dax, Justin, I grew up kasi, you know, with my dad, and my dad always found his way of hanging around older people. So ako, I grew up in the business na mga laging mas matatanda yung kasama sa office. So when I joined camp, it seemed very, you know, comfortable.
Wait
and
lang,
very...
parang sinasabi mo.
Hindi, sinasabi ko, na ginagawa ko yung sinasabi ni Sir Ben. Surround yourself with
totoo yan.
Older people have wisdom.
Camp is 70. Totoo yung sa Ducks, ang average age ng mga camp, 70.
Yes, sir. Okay, I have attended one of your meetings and...
So yung advocacy nating mga kabataan pagpasok sa camp ay flatten the curve na
the age curve.
Yes, the age curve. Pero maganda po yung mga sinasabi nila ni Sir Ben and ni Doc Emilio na
grabe.
Find a mentor consciously, have a conscious effort of finding it, but you also enrich yourself. And then eventually you find a way to pass the baton that you also be a mentor eventually. And I think that's something for young people to look into, no? Kasi sirs, if you notice po, no, the young people or even, you know, our contemporaries, very reliant na on the digital communications, etc. Somehow, yung meaningful discussions on a face-to-face, of course, without the, assuming, you know, yung wala pang COVID, medyo na di-distance po siya. And yung factor of trying to be mentored and be a mentor, medyo hindi siya explicitly talaga sinasabi sa institutions, but that's something for young people to really be aware of, na dapat conscious sila maghanap ng mentor, know where they want to go, and then be a mentor and enrich themselves and be a mentor. Maganda.
Nagustuhan ko yung sinabi din ni Doc Emil na magbasa ng history. Parang,
yes.
Kasi meron ako naalala na parang quote or phrase, parang, it is wise to learn from your mistakes, but it is wiser to learn from the mistakes of others.
So, yes. Very true.
So, nakasulat naman na yan. So, parang, I think, yes, the importance of reading. So, in a way, that's also a form of mentorship, I think, yung true. Pagbabasa ng history. And sabi nga ni...
Yes.
And I think, echoing yung sentiments ni Doc Emil and ni Doc Ben, na parang, I think their careers has been similar to a relay race or a baton race, ano? Parang, so their mentors pass the baton to them, the knowledge, the wisdom, and then they continued it, they ran with it, and then now it is time for them to pass their own batons to the people who will take it to the next 50 or 60 years. So, grabe, ang aga-aga ang daming lessons.
Hindi ko na kailangan ng kape to stimulate my brain.
Na-ano ako?
Na-stimulate ako sa bars of wisdom.
By the way,
Si Bards, anong
yes, Bards.
Anong masabi mo doon, Bards?
I was blown away. Yes. Hindi, as in, kanina talaga, ako kasi, ang character ko, alam niyo naman na yan, na laging, ano ako, observing and observing info. Pero, yun nga, parang mas sinundan ko yung thought process ng lahat. Parang napareflect ako na, ako, ano to, on a personal level, parang, as a youth, na-exhaust ko ba lahat ng means to parang find a mentor or to learn from them or even learning myself, no, with reading much or with researching and working with other people continuously. So siguro ang takeaway ko dito, at sana takeaway doon ng mga tao or mga kabataan ngayon, na since we are already being passed on with the baton, baka naman din tayo din, no, parang gawin natin yung fair share to parang prepare ourselves then, because we are parang in the front line na sooner or later to mentor naman din and
yes,
can I say parang something in addition to mentoring?
Go ahead, Sir Ben.
Yes po.
In terms of how you get up along with the IQ, I think more important is emotional intelligence, EQ. You have to relate with everybody around you. In fact, you probably, that is so important. If you're in an organization, anybody can sit you down. But so in mga interactions, no, you have to be important. You have to be aware of the social dynamics. Important thing, ante. You have to make your superiors happy. You have to interact with your peers so that they, when they work with you. And then yung mga subordinates mo, you have to ensure that the subordinate will help you because one of them can sabotage you. There's two stories I want to share with you. There's an exam in one university, and one of the questions asked has nothing to do with this subject matter. The question was, was the janitor who keeps our room and only two people got it. But some people were aware enough of the people under them that they knew the name of the janitor. Ako, when I retired, they made a video. I was the only guy who retired during that year I retired, yung mga senior management ng UNILAB.
Mm-hmm.
One of the people they interviewed was our Xerox guy, yung si Xerox Carmen. Sabi niya doon, whenever I meet Doc Ben in the hallway, sabi niya, sabi ko raw sa kanya, Boyet, kumusta ka na? And you know, he remembered that. The fact that this guy who was a Xerox copier, nobody pays attention to him, I always made it a point. I took a few moments to find out how he's doing, and he loved it. So yung ganung attitude. You have to have emotional intelligence. Maybe, I know, Andrew might want to say something about it. Because I know, nag-uusap kami nung mapunta kami sa mga talk sa Manila, he used to share with me how he made sure that he will not have any financial problems running UP. Emil!
yeah, tama yung sabi ni, ano, ni Ben Pekson. By the way, Ben Pekson is a drug pusher, baka hindi nyo alam.
Pamya, may makarinig na rin niya. Kala rin.
As he worked for you, Unilab. Yeah. Unilab.
Joke lang yan kasi vice president siya for R&D sa Unilab. Kaya I fondly call him the drug pusher.
Pero, pet name lang po yun. Pet name lang po.
Tama yung sinasabi ni Dr. Ben. Kasi sa buhay, mahalaga pero hindi sapat yung substantive knowledge of the content ng anumang hinaharap mo. Pero kailangan yun. But then you must have the ability of to relate with people because you can never, well, you could do a lot on your own but you could do more if you work with others. And yun ang technique sa buhay, with your friends, with family, with everybody. You must have a good understanding of how the person across you feels and you're able to put yourself in his or her shoes. Because yun ang basis naman ng human relationships. And that has served me well because for people who don't know me, most of my achievements have been related to building institutions. I put up the Institute of Plant Breeding, the biotech, and sa UP, marami yun, yung Open University, UP Mindanao, and so forth and so on. I could not have done all of those on my own. It could have been, it was possible only because I was able to work with a lot of people who, many of whom know more than I did, but we were able to come together and achieve a common purpose. So kailangan yung ano yung EQ. Although kailangan muna naintindihan mo yung subject matter kasi how can you be a leader kung hindi mo alam kung saan kayo pupunta? Dapat alam mo kung saan ka pupunta.
So and magbasa yung, po ulit, sir.
And then you must find how you're going to persuade other people to think the way that you do and travel together to a common destination. So in the end, napakahalaga noon yung sinasabi ni Dr. Ben EQ. And that is something that we can learn and be purposive about. Dapat yung ano yung attitude mo na hindi naman kailangan ikong daldal ng daldal, makinig ka muna. Kasi yung mga makaharap mo, maraming alam yun na makakatulong sa iyo. And you know, yun ang mga lessons sa buhay. Pero lagi sinasabi ko, you better understand the subject first as best as you can. Kasi ang unang tanong ay, saan ka pupunta? Saan mo gusto magpunta? kung hindi mo alam yun, mahirap.
Oo nga po, sir.
Bagay.
Tama po yun.
Pero balik tayo kay Ben. Kasi mahaba na istorya namin ni Ben. Si Ben, siya ang prime mover ng Biotech Coalition of the Philippines. Kasi si Ben, being a drug pusher, naintindihan niya yun. Ako naman, naintindihan ko rin yun. Because although I was a plant breeder, ang una kong major noon ay sugar tech, katulad ni Ben. Kasi yon at that time, in Los Baños, yun ang glamour course. Yung pinaka mga smart students were in biotech. Eh pero sabi ni Dr. Mali, huwag ka na dyan sa sugar tech, sa plant breeding ka na lang. Mas may pag-asa ka sa plant breeding kaysa sugar tech. Kaya ako plant breeder. But anyway, si Ben ang nagdala sa atin yung Biotech Coalition. That was a very successful effort and he was behind that. And then later on, ito namang camp. Si Ben din ang spirit behind camp. And a lot of that is because of his background. And yung lagi niyang mantra na, it's time to pay back. It's time to pay back. Kasi Ben is very comfortably located in the US, but still he came back because kanyang mantra is payback time. So yung sa camp, kami naman, most of us are senior, unlike si Jim. And no, we are together because of that. that notion we have benefited so well, especially from our UP education, and it's time that we pay back.
Yeah. Talagang para sa bayan.
Sir Ben, we can't hear you.
Sir?
Wala si Ben, wala si Ben.
Walang audio po, sir.
Sir Ben?
Yeah, malakas.
Ayan, ayan, okay.
I wanted to say something about the camp. Actually, camp was created because we were really outraged that the coconut farmers had a very raw deal. Inolekta yung kokolegi sa kanila over a period of about 11 years, and they haven't got much out of it. And a few select people made a lot of money, tons of money. But all this was all because money was accumulated at the back of coconut farmers. And until now, they are not competitive. But one of the first things we did was with Dr. Bernardo, Emil, and other people, we figured the best way to handle this is through legislation. So we drafted the very first bill for the coconut ready fund. And President Duterte mentioned it na at his last corner. And my understanding is May, end of May, nag-uumpisa na si Senator Villar to make it happen. So hopefully, because of him, roughly 105 billion pesos will get back to the coconut farmers. Hopefully. Yan ang isang one of the things we hope we can accomplish through him. 105 billion. Maraming pera yun.
I think that's a big, sabi niyo nga, payback, ano? 105 billion, madaming payback yun.
That would definitely boost the coconut industry and help our farmers. Yeah.
Okay, before we proceed, I would just like to greet some members of the audience. Watching from Pagadian City, Zamboanga del Sur, Mr. Robert Rivamonte. Good morning, sir. Andrew Gasmen says, very inspiring, Sir Emil. 2 years of no good result, but later became part of a big accomplishment. So, ayan. So, maraming nanonood ngayon. And merong nagtanong about camp and the coconut industry. I think I will ask this later during another segment. But, ayan, also, meron pa mga ibang nagsasabi. Another, watching from Metro Manila, panibagong kaalaman na naman. So, ayan, thank you. Ito po, my father greets former UP President Emil Javier and Brad Benigno Pexon, 65, from Joseph Alfindo, 75. Obsidon din po ang father ka. And actually, my younger brother as well. So, ayan po, sabi nila, learn from his, sabi po ng isang comment, learn from history, learn from the best mentors, and be a mentor yourself for the future generation. What a wealth of wisdom. Thanks, yes. Sir Emil and Doc Ben, and thanks to Dream Agritech as well. Ayun, so, yes. Wala, parang ang bilis nung 1 hour na pala tayong nag-uusap, pero parang bago lang. So, Justin, nandiyan ka pa ba? I think nagkaroon siya ng connection problem.
Technical problem. So, yes, I'm here. Okay, all right.
So habang lumalaban ka, bro, can you ask our guests yung next question natin?
Ah, wait, wala pa natin.
Yung
second one.
Kung papa yung
para kasi na daanan na din yung ano no, yung industry and yung how does one end up like them, it's already been
discussed.
I think been discussed na rin. Siguro, ito, yung isa sa mga great questions here. No? Yung how do you see agriculture progressing in our country? Was this being answered na ba or
Hindi pa.
Hindi
pa.
Or na-miss ko lang.
I think it's a good question. It's a good question. Paunahin natin si Doc Ben naman this time.
As far as agriculture, we haven't been, yung productivity natin sa agriculture compared to the population growth, mahina. We're growing mga 1% lang. Our population is growing a lot faster. I don't know if I can show this. Nakikita ba ito?
Anyway, ayan sir, kita po.
What I want to show is that anyway, ganito. The China, the projected growth by 2050, there will from 1.439 billion now, there will be 1.4 billion Chinese na lang. In year 2100, 1.065 na lang sila. Paliit ang population ng China. By contrast, India, nag-grow ang population nila. There are 1.38 billion now. By 2050, there will be 1.6 billion of them. Sa US, mag-increase from 331 million now to 379 in 2050 to 434 in 2011. The Philippines, they're now at 110, and then in 2050, they'll be 144 and 146 in 2100. And Metro Manila is now the top 15 cities. We're now at 14.81 million. In 2050, we'll be projected to 23.55 million. And 2100, there will be 40 million of us in Metro Manila. So from the patterns of population growth, we can see China decreasing. So they'll need less food. India, magiging competitor natin yan along with Pakistan. And a lot of other African countries. You know, the largest city after so many years will be Kinshasa. So they're part of that.
Zaire. It's
possible. Africa. Mm. So anywhere, ang competitor natin, according to yung population, will be Africa, India, and Pakistan. America will continue to produce a lot of food. Tayo, parang sagad na tayo. And yet, we will have Metro Manila, palakas ang population growth. We're all among the few countries na we will have a high population growth. We have limited capability to produce food. So we'll have to import. Kaya importante alam natin sinong competitor natin. What will happen is along with Nepal and Pakistan, we will continue to export Filipinos, overseas workers. And it's their money coming back which will provide food for the country. At the same time, that means that we'll be more dependent on imports. And which is a dangerous situation. So we will have to do what we can with urban agriculture and find ways so that we can produce more food. And di ang kailangan siguro, we have to bring more food from the ocean because we have 10 times more ocean than we have land. Anyway, what I wanted to say is the person who's really studying this is Dr. Rasko, Dr. Yufani Rasko. I hope you invite him to come here and he'll be happy to talk with you because along with a lot of very intelligent people, he's trying to get a price on food.
And systems.
Food. Yeah, he will study this. He's studying this and we're in the process. We're among the finalists. Out of 300 applicants worldwide, mga 70 yeah. And yung finalists were one of them. The other thing I want to say is there's a very good book by Paul Teng from Singapore along with a young lady, Food and the Future of Food. Paul saying that agriculture will end. Things. The idea is it possible to have agriculture without animals? Is it possible to have food security without agriculture? And again, I'm talking to young people because we don't have it yet. But in other countries, they already have Impossible Burger and Beyond Burger. You can produce meats at a fraction of the effort using animals. And then, natutuwa pa yung mga animal lovers. You don't have to kill animals anymore. So there are all of these possibilities. You could have aquaculture in the city. you could have controlled conditions, you can produce fish. Mas mahal siya, but then you are selling to the city because there's a successful company in Singapore, in downtown Singapore, he produces in downtown profitably. So there's opportunity now for people who are competent, smart, and entrepreneurial. And wala ka pang boss.
Wala ka pang boss. Yun yung best. That's the best one. All right.
Anyway, agriculture will change a lot. And, you know, we don't have to be married to agriculture and producing food. You could use biotechnology. By the way, sinabi kanina ni Emil yung, I mean, the drug industry. Because most of the money in biotech is invested in the health area. Siguro 90% of the money is invested there. And there's no problem because people will really accept it for health reasons. But yung 10% which is invested in agriculture, may problema tayo sa regulatory process natin sa not only in the Philippines, but all over the world. So that's one of my other advocacy. How can we utilize biotechnology more sensibly? Because there are some people who don't like biotech just because it's new. But we have responsible science. We've been using so-called GMOs for more than 2 decades. And there is not a single case that's bad for you. It's safe. And people, including our lawmakers, still don't understand it. So we're there to help them.
Yes, bridge the knowledge gap, so to speak. Okay, so Doc Emil, we're also interested, and we await your prognosis for the future of agriculture.
Okay. Andale. Sige, tama yung sinasabi ni Dr. Ben, yung future, and there's so many things that are going to come to pass. Ang aking concern is the here and now. Now, my analysis is like this. We have the temperature and the sunlight, mm-hmm. but most importantly, we have the water.
Yes.
Sa agriculture lang naman eh, yung temperature, sunlight, well, soils and water. Now, yung ating soils ay volcanic in origin, many of them. So, they're inherently fertile. And then water, we have 2,400 millimeters rainfall every year on the average. Yun ang pag-aawayan sa buong mundo, yung fresh water. Mm. But God, of course, God gave us typhoons also, but God gave us plenty of water. So, ang immediate challenge natin is to capture the water.
Yes,
for our needs.
Water, yeah.
Okay, now, we are doing badly in agriculture, if you compare us with the ASEAN. Ang aking analysis is because we are not very smart in managing the supply chain of agriculture from growing to processing, marketing, and so on.
Yes.
And the big problem is ang agriculture natin is dominated by small farms, small farmers.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? And that problem is getting worse because of agrarian reform and inheritance. But ang problem is our small farmers are not formally integrated in the supply chain. Itchapwera sila. So yun ang unang-unang issue. How do we
integrate?
Manage our affairs so that the small farmers are formally
part of the
of the supply chain. Now, isa pa legislation, policies, and so on. Hindi totoo yun eh. Kalimitan ng legislation, policy, nandiyan na eh. Napakagaling natin. Napakarami nating batas. Ang problema, smart program planning and execution.
Implementation.
So yung aking analysis, how do you now put the farmers formally in the supply chain and make them part of the supply chain? So walang ang isang solution diyan ay yung contract farming, because you have they should be part of the supply chain na yung mga integrators are going to supply the the growers with seeds, breeding stock, and fertilizers and feeds, and guarantee them price of the produce at the end. So dapat yun ang dapat ganun ang pamantayan natin. How do you put in the small farmers in the supply chain? And one of them is by contract growing, and there are all kinds of modalities.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So hangga't maaari, kasi ang kita sa supply chain hindi sa primary production. Ang kita lagi ay doon sa processing and marketing.
Sa dulo.
Pero ang mga farmers natin, sa primary production sila. Kaya lagi silang aping-api. So the farmers should be encouraged to become processors themselves.
Yes.
Kasi nandun ang kita. Or yung sa value adding.
Mm-hmm.
Kaya yun, isang ano yun, make them processors themselves. Or insist that if they are going to be raw material suppliers to the integrators, over time, the farmers should have an equity in the processing plant.
Yeah, since they provide the raw materials.
Raw materials, so meron kang credit. Over time, meron kang equity in the processing plant.
Yeah.
So ang kita ng small farmers is raw material supplier, laborer, under correct wages. At the same time, meron siyang dividend at the end of the day. So dapat ganun ang ating, basically ganun ang approach to agriculture.
Modern.
Making the small guys formal part of the supply chain, and the big guys guaranteeing fair value at the end, and the small farmers becoming processors themselves, or if not, they should be equity holders in the processing plant. So yun ang aking basic formula on the way forward. But going back, ang pinaka-importante, meron tayong tubig. Meron tayong tubig, kaya we have to have more dams and small ponds and all kinds of water holding devices.
Mm-hmm.
Kasi in the end, ayun, nag-aaway na sa Mekong Valley. Ha? Nag-aaway na yung China and all those countries. Yung Nile River mula Ethiopia, Sudan, Somalia, nag-aaway na sila dyan. Everywhere in the world, yan, Tigris, Euphrates, pag-aawayan lagi ang tubig. Pero tayo, marami tayong tubig. So we must keep that in mind. We must capture and hold on to that fresh water, because that is key to progressive agriculture in the far future.
There's something I want to add pala to all of this discussion about agriculture in the future. I don't know if you've noticed it. Maraming malnutrition sa Philippines. At the same time, marami tayong obese people. Marami na yung overweight. And the incidence of diabetes in our country is going up. Parang we need a lot more diverse foods. The main, palaging prominent ang food natin is rice, a little bit of corn, we consume wheat. Those are the basic cereals. But we have to diversify our food. At the same time, we have to take care of our environment. Although we need to develop agriculture, kailangan din natin we pay attention to our heritage. How do we develop without forgetting our heritage? Ang dami nating mga foods.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, we have what, 5,000 yung species we can eat. But we're only consuming a very, very narrow range of food. And like I pointed out, may malnutrition, and yet we have diabetes. We have to have a better way of handling yung food security by utilizing the resources that we already have and taking care of the environment. So natin kalimutan yung we have to be a good mag-handle ng environment. The term is facing me right now, but we should be aware of the environment.
Yes. Grabe. Based going off on what medyo na si speechless ako sa mga naririnig ko. No? But going off on what Dr. Emil said, that the Philippines has been so blessed. And we agree kasi yun po one of the reasons why our small startup was put up, kasi we we were trying to look at the Philippines and nagtataka kami bakit sobrang merong may deficit in food production. And when we compare ourselves to other countries na merong temperate climates, harsher climates, or not really friendly to growing animals and plants, parang bakit tayo, why are we lagging behind? And I think one of the main reasons is the lack of yung the technical transfer of skills from the universities, from the laboratories, from the research institutions to the actual users, the farmers or the farm owners. And dun po kami, yun po yung ini-endeavor namin ni Jim and ni Bartz na punan yung parang since we have background, since we come from a research university, and since meron kaming direct interface with farmers or farm owners, that's where we come in and we try to bridge that gap. So we try to transfer the knowledge and the wisdom from you to the users to effectively grow agriculture, and also to encourage people to invest. Kasi one of the main reasons na narinig namin from landowners, kaya hindi sila nag-invest kahit may mga lupa sila kasi wala naman daw silang alam or wala naman silang background or they don't know the first thing about agriculture. And I think bilang bata pa kami, kaya pa naming mag-field, kaya pa naming pumunta kung saan-saan ng walang problema. And I think that's, in this time of our life, I think that's the role that we seek to fulfill. And ayun, sobrang...
Kaya ng drone ko pumunta sa malayo.
Pero ikaw. Pero ikaw.
yung drone ko yung papuntahin ko sa malayo.
One of the things that camp is doing is extension. We really, ang daming mga problema sa agriculture, but we try to narrow them down to a few. We came down to about 6. And one of the things to be solved is, ang mahina natin is extension. You remember nung devolution of extension, dati-dati central yan from the Department of Agriculture. And then extension, yeah, became job of the LGUs. And we have results because of that. Maybe I'll ask Emil to explain what we're doing since extension, because we met with Secretary Piñol before, and now we're cooperating with Secretary Dara about it. Emil, explain some of it.
Yes, sir, yes.
As a consequence of the EDSA revolution, and then the global tide of democratization, participation, and so on, na-decentralize ang agriculture extension and also help to the provinces. As a principle, tama yon, because the delivery of services is in the hands of the instruments of government closest to the people. So, tama yon, di ba? Ang problema, we didn't realize that the municipalities are too small to provide that coordination of the delivery of extension.
Mm-hmm.
So now, belatedly, we are pushing na dapat yung decentralization should really be ang locus of decentralization ought to be the province instead of the municipality. Pero ang problema niya, kailangan babaguhin natin yung local government code. Mahabang story yan. So ang solution natin temporizing by reorganizing extension but focusing them at the provincial level. So yung province-led collaborative extension service, yun ang pinupus ng CAP. Yun naman, tinanggap ni Secretary Piñol at ngayon Secretary Dar. Ang idea is, since we cannot enforce that legally because we need a law, use the funds of DA as a way of bringing people together. So yung pera ng DA, ilagay natin sa probinsya so that the municipal offices would readily collaborate with the province. Kasi ang pondo ng gobyerno is flowing through the province. Mm-hmm. So ngayon, yan ang story in progress na hindi pa natin talaga nagagawa. Nagkaroon ng MOA in Ilocos Norte, and now there are discussions pero na overtake ng COVID. But the idea really is to make the province as the locus of program planning and execution of agriculture and fisheries. Kasi yung nag-over-decentralize tayo all the way to the municipality. And most municipalities, except for the rich ones, ang problema, yung mga mayaman yun, hindi naman nila kailangan ng tulong eh.
Hindi na rin nila.
Ang nangangailangan ng tulong, yung third, fourth, fifth, sixth class municipalities,
yes.
Yung mga pobre. Eh, nandun ang agriculture and fisheries.
Yes.
So, yun ang advocacy ng CAMP. Move extension planning, program planning, execution to the province level.
I'd like to add to what Emil is saying. Itong programa, it's a tripartite. We have the national government, sometimes to the regional offices. And then we have the governor and yung grupo niya. And important, that you mentioned earlier, you don't have much interaction with the state colleges and universities. We will use those so that yung R&D available in near the province, yung state university malapit doon.
So
we have that state colleges and universities ang halige, isa yung DA national, and then the provincial level. We have three groups working together.
Sir, if I may, sir, I think I'd jump in on that also. There is a role to play also for the private sector.
Absolutely.
That would be very crucial in these provinces. Normally, especially in the conferences or in the discussions I've been in with the Global Forum for Rural Advisory Services, which is the Global Network for Extension Forum. There's always, when we talk about extension, the premise of people is always that it's government-led, it's public funds. But then there's a resurgence in also looking into how private sector can play a part in extension.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Dream Agritech is just one of many other service providers that aims to do that. And I hope that we can also tap, private sectors in the province levels where this provincial-led extension system would be in place. It would be nice na ma-tap din po ang mga private sector players in those areas po.
I think, Jim, you're in the right direction. Although government can make some money available, at the end of the day, what we need is a lot more people in the private sector will provide the resources necessary to make this happen. Pinaka-importante yung private sector. But we have to nurture and make sure that hindi sila madedihado. It becomes a little more complicated when we talk about trade. But private sector is a very, very important sector because they're efficient, they're fast, and they kailangan natin ang funds which will be generated. At the end of the day, we want a lot more people, yung overseas worker, to invest into agriculture.
Yes.
And maybe doable now with the technology. Overseas worker, sabi niya, I'll be investor in your farm as long as I can see the progress being made. Kailangan talaga ang private sector.
Emphasis on private sector with a heart po.
Hindi, kasama yung sa 8-point paradigm ni Secretary Dar. So, kasama yung private sector involvement, yung industry associations, tapos yung mga cooperative, the farmers themselves,
yes.
and the input suppliers. Malaki din ang magagawa nila dyan. Pero kasama yun, yung the 8-point paradigm ni Secretary Dar.
Sir, I have been meaning to ask this since you brought it up. Sir, nabanggit nyo na because of the Agrarian Reform Law, we have effectively reduced yung average landholding ng isang Filipino. I think it's around 1.2 to 1.5 hectares on a national average. So, are there any feasible or possible workarounds on this matter? Or what do you see? Or what would you posit as a suggestion or unsolicited advice to policymakers? Ano yung workaround on the very divided, or for lack of a better, divided land areas.
Sige, okay. And before that, let me give a background about agrarian reform.
Okay.
Yung agrarian reform, hindi lamang man tayo yan eh. Yung panahon ng Greeks and Romans, meron na rin silang agrarian reform.
Mm-hmm.
The French Revolution, the Mexican Revolution, the Bolshevik Revolution, lahat yan meron agrarian reform. But agrarian reform really have two purposes. One is for regime status quo or regime change, political yon. The other one is for higher efficiency, productivity. But all over the world, over civilization, agrarian reforms normally succeeded in their political aims, but they don't succeed in the economic efficiency purposes. Now, madaling sisihin si Marcos at si Cory. But you know, the Republic was in peril at that time. The left was very strong. They were about to take over. And so, kumbaga sa chess, President Marcos and then Cory, forced move yun eh. Mga tawag doon swug-swang. So they have to declare agrarian reform for political, to save the Republic, so to speak. By now, they succeeded, di ba? The Republic is stable, although marami tayong problema. So it's really time to say we have declared victory in agrarian reform and to move on. Now, yung 5-hectare limitation. Pero, if you reverse that, bubuhayin mo yung mga kaibigan natin in the left. Kaya, hindi magalaw ni ng mga pangulo natin ng Kongreso and even the President. Kasi kailangan mo, you must have a lot of political capital to reverse agrarian reform. And nobody would dare do that, even Duterte. So, unfortunately, we just have to live with the agrarian reform until the political climate changes so that we can declare victory and reverse the hectare limit. So ngayon, ano ang tanong? Well, yung unang-una, yung contract farming, because you go around the problem of land title and ownership because you are now managing agriculture in larger units, yung contract growing, yung auto approach, and mga cooperatives. Yun mga ways of going around the problem of land ownership. Kasi the other one is change the law and custom na lahat ng lupa mag-inherit lamang yung panganay. Eh, hindi papasa sa Congress yun. Ilan lang ang panganay sa Congress eh. Di ba? So, you know, it's like batting your head against the wall. So ako, tahimik na ako doon. Ang kailangan natin, how do you go around it? Contract growing, cooperative, irrigators association, ayong mga processing, equity in processing plants. Yun mga pwedeng magawa within the existing legal and constitutional framework.
Mm-hmm.
Yung changing yung agrarian reform, sabi ko,
uphill battle.
Uphill yun, baka I'm already 80 years old, baka wala na ako, nadyan pa yun eh. So, pero maraming magagawa. Yung contract farming, cooperatives, irrigators association, beneficiaries association, dapat lahat ng pondo natin doon natin i-course, including the industry associations. So yun ang maraming pwedeng magawa.
Sir Ben, would you like to add to that or would you like to
We can learn from the successful countries which have agrarian reform and do all right. Taiwan or Japan, they have the same sort of thing, but they're able to produce anyway. So we have to learn from those and see anong mga practices that they're doing which made them successful. But yung lahat ng mga sinasabi ni Emil, the ones which are doable, we have to do those. But we still have a lot to learn.
Yes. We are...
Yung sa Japan, nandun si MacArthur. At saka sa Taiwan na yung Kumintang. Anyway, at saka yung culture of solidarity ng mga tao.
Yeah.
Kaya ang lakas ng mga cooperatives doon eh, sa Taiwan. I live in Taiwan for 4 years. Napakalakas ng mga cooperative nila, even in Japan. So yes, yun ang kailangan pag-aralan natin. How do we bring people, the Filipinos together to rally around the Farmers Association and cooperative, so they can work together collectively.
Mm-hmm.
Kasi yung isa-isang farmer talagang malabo yun, malabo yun. Mm-hmm. So we can learn from them.
Mm-hmm. We need to organize the farmers and formally integrate them into the
supply chain.
Yes.
Parang ano, I'm always reminded of that parang idiom nga bang tawag doon, na parang kung yung walis tingting mag-isa lang, walang malilinis yan. Pero kung nakabungkos yan, kasama yung ibang walis tingting, marami tayong magagawa. So parang, I think, tama ba sir? Tama ba?
Tama yan.
Hey, you want to ask questions from the audience?
Yes, sir.
We still have some questions.
Actually, madaming questions dito. I think we'll start off with one of them. Magandang umaga po. Base sa advocacy ng CAM, malaki ang may tutulong ng grupo ni na Dr. Javier and Dr. Pexon sa pagsusulong ng kaunlaran sa ating coconut industry. Meron po ba kayong ugnayan sa PCA na naglalayon na maitaas ang antas ng kalagayan ng ating mga magdyonyog sa Pilipinas? Salamat po. From Cornelio Molon.
I think we have just started that. Si Emil will be the new head of the advisory committee. Emil, ikaw na mag-explain.
Magandang balita kasi we have a new administrator of PCA sa katauhan ni Lieutenant General Benjamin Madrigal, retired Chief of Armed Forces, na taga Bambang Los Baños yata si General. Graduate yun ng rural.
Ah, opo.
Kaya minsan mas magaling yung rural kaysa sa Pedro Guevara.
Pero minsan lang, minsan lang.
Paminsan-minsan. biro lang yan. But anyway, with our new administrator, and Administrator Madrigal reached out to CAMP. So nakadalawa na kaming meeting sa kanya. And so we are now working closely with him in the transformation of PCA, in the development of a roadmap, and now bringing those ideas to the level of the province. Yan ay ginagawa natin sa Quezon because we are in close contact with Obet Gaho, yung provincial agriculturist ng Quezon. Kasi ang Quezon, 70% niyan coconut. So coconut modernization is a very important component of the Quezon plan. Mm-hmm. So tinutuhog natin yung province-led. So yung province-led, ang nagdadala niyan si Obet Gaho ng provision ng Quezon, of course with the Governor Suarez. Ngayon, dinuduksungan ngayon ng PCA kung ano magagawa ng PCA. Pero ang magdadala ay yung probinsya.
Mm-hmm.
So tinutulungan natin ang PCA ngayon to make that happen. Province-led, ang PCA tutulong sa probinsya ng Quezon, at yan ay toward the transformation of PCA itself and NDA. So maganda ang mga pangitain natin. CAMP is now working closely with the PCA. At mga recently, hiniling ni Admin Madrigal na ang CAMP ang mag-manage ng webinar series for the coconut industry on coconut month, coconut week.
Mm-hmm.
Hindi naman namin alam nila Ben yan eh, nila Roger Cuino. Kaya hinila namin si Jim. Kasi yung webinar, hindi namin alam yan, yung mga matatanda. Pero yung sila, kayo Doc, sila Jim. Pero kami ang ni-request ni General Madrigal. So we have pulled Jim. So we are now sitting together with PCA and si Deputy Lynn Manuhar, Deputy Roel Rosales, kung ano ang gagawin. Pero ang bottom line, General Madrigal reached out to CAMP and CAMP is only too willing to help in whatever we can in pushing for the modernization of the coconut industry and generating jobs higher incomes and so forth and so on for our coconut farmers.
Okay, can I add to that?
Yes, you know, sir.
It's a good thing now that we have a close relationship with General Madrigal, but it will even be better through yung bill na pinal ni Senator Villar and si House, because if that bill goes through, there'll be a lot of money for the farmers and also the budget of the PCA malaki, lalaki, because in the previous administrations, because for whatever reasons, yung budget ng PCA pababa. Maabot ng more than 4 billion. Ngayon, nasa more than 1 billion na lang. But if the Coco Levy Fund, the way we saw it before, happens, the budget of PCA can be as much as 10 billion a year. That makes a huge difference. So anyway, two things. Sana ma-sign na yung Coconut Levy Fund bill maging law. That happens, okay tayo. And the good thing that happens is we have General Madrigal, who's very open and he's thinking ahead. In fact, yung kanyang plano, hindi lang during the next 18 months, during December 30. The guy is so forward-looking. He has a plan that extends for up until
18 years. Formation plan of PCA led by General Madrigal. Mm-hmm. Very forward-looking.
You have good strategic plans. I can see you have about 3 million land there, which is not optimally used. We can have coffee and cacao underneath, and maybe other smaller animals or plants underneath. The coconut industry is really underperforming. And it's now, I think, we see opportunities occurring, particularly with the leadership of General Madrigal. But sana, President Duterte, kung ma-sign niya yung Coconut Levy Fund release along with allocations for PCA up to 10 billion, we can do so much for the coconut industry. We started that process, sana naman mangyari na.
Yeah. It's very promising to hear po. Sana makatulong din po kami sa
okay.
In the industry roadmap and in the implementation part po.
Mm-hmm. Please let us know how we can help, especially if that plan is like you said, forward looking. So bale po kami po ang
we'll run with the baton po.
Kami po ang sasalo. So to speak. But ayun, sir, so that's parang Quezon is gonna be one of the epicenters of coconut development, from what I've heard, and I think that also goes into the observation of both Doc Ben and Doc Emil na yung least developed municipalities, the 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th class municipalities, are the agricultural epicenters of their own respective provinces. So I think that is a model that we are looking forward to, yung province-led extension and the cascading of agricultural development through to grants, to modernization through the provincial offices or at the provincial level. So
can I add something to that, Dax?
Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
One of the most important things is ang average yield natin ngayon in the Philippines is only 43 to 45 nuts per tree per year. One of the things that we need is we have to produce millions of hybrids. We have 300 million coconut and about 20% of the female. Emil already started the process. We can produce a lot of hybrids. Emil, yung ginagawa mo sa hybrids, can you explain something for about it to give more idea that, hey, we're moving ahead?
Yeah. Actually, ang PCA has been doing its job. The PCA over the years has developed mga 12 to 15 hybrids. Ngayon, ang problema, wala silang commercial program. Pero 2 years ago, tayo, si Erlene Manuhar, yung deputy of PCA for Calabarzon and so on. At saka si Ramon Rivera, our breeder.
LB din yan, sir. LB din po yan.
Oh, LB yun. Breeder din yun. So now we have a program for producing hybrids. The idea is to have at least 100,000 dwarf palm trees as parents, of which 20,000 are now existing in the PCA experiment stations. And now we are in the process of identifying and planting 80,000 more in the hands of the small farmers. So last year, PCA produced 500,000 hybrid nuts, seedlings. This year, ang target, mga 1.2, 1.5 million. So it's on the way. Ang kumikilos dyan is si Erlin Manuhar at saka si Ramon Rivera, si Jerry Bailon, mga taga PCA yan.
Si Director Bailon.
Oh, yan, mga Los Baños graduate yan. So PCA is on its way on the hybrid part. Ginagawa na yan, ginagawa na yan.
So kailangan lang po ng mga commercial partners po to help roll out those seedlings.
Can I add to that? Yeah, we're talking about hybrids na lang. The thing that came into my head, for young entrepreneurs, one business which can make money with maybe not too much land is to produce the necessary seeds. Kulang tayo ng seed production in the Philippines. That's an open area for potential entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
Yeah, totoo yan. Jim, you know, that's if yung young people listening, you volunteer to PCA to become a hybrid seed producer. If you have 2 to 4 hectares of coconut,
yeah,
then we will provide you with dwarf seedlings, huh? And,
yes,
and then later on you can be the seed producer.
Yes, bro. Actually, I contacted the PCA coordinator po sa Region 7, sir, kasi we have the property in Bohol. I wanted to avail of that, kasi they'll pay you they'll give you the seed nuts for you to grow, and then they'll buy it from you at a certain price, or you can sell it at a certain price. So I looked into the business model of it. Interesting yun, and I think that's very promising for young people na may mga ganung area po. Kaso nagka-COVID, di po ako makapunta ng Bohol.
So nakatip na naman tayo dito sa Agri ka ba?
Yes, actually papunta na yun sa yung 3-2-1 natin na game.
Nakatip na naman tayo kasi last week our Agri attaché to the Americas, sabi niya, coconut, virgin coconut oil and coconut derivative products are in for export. So it plays into hybrid production and yung hybrid seedlings, and I think it was spoken by Dr. Batugal, no? The right time to plant coconut was last year or last 5 years ago. So eto na. Late man, makakarating din. But yes, and we are glad to know that PCA now is being guided by Dr. Javier, and now he is we're very much looking forward to how it plays out, sir. Lalo na po yung 18-year roadmap, because yun nga po pagdating nung time na yon,
49
48 na ako noon.
I'll be 49 by then.
Hindi, kaya nga tuwan-tuwa kami nila, Ben. Kasi for the first time, here you have an agency head who is not planning only for tomorrow. General Madrigal was planning for three presidential terms.
Yeah.
6 years, 18 years transformation of PCA. Kaya nang narinig namin, abay, nakakaintindi itong matandang ito. Itong batang ito, magaling. Bata pa si General Madrigal eh. That's why we are very happy to hear meron siyang transformation roadmap, because ngayon lang kami naka-encounter na agency head who is planning way beyond this term. Sabi niya, hindi naman para bukas ito eh.
Wala na
ako dyan, but then yung institution. Kaya nga, we are very happy to be associated with Admin Madrigal. Malayo ang mararating natin with the coconut now.
Nice. Sabi nga nila, sana all.
Yes. Sana all agency.
Okay, so before we, grabe, 1 hour 45 minutes na tong discussion natin according to our live timer. So
it's very, very substantial.
Very substantial. So before, I think we have a few more, couple more questions from the audience. But before that, Jim or Bards, baka meron pa kayong mga follow-up questions para sa ating speakers. Bards, baka Justin. Meron ka pa?
Oh, I'm good na.
Alright.
Super.
Okay, so ito sir, medyo mga prognostications po ulit. To President Emil and Brad Ben, do you see any future for hemp, for fiber, food, fuel, biodegradable plastic, and medicine in the Philippines? Hemp po as a species. Meron po ba daw future yan?
Obviously, meron tayong yung abaca itself, which is a well acceptable natural fiber. In fact, we are leader and practically the only exporter of abaca. Na dapat pagyamanin natin yung abaca. Mm-hmm. Ngayon, ang malaking problema sa abaca is viruses. Kaya after 60 years, yung plant breeding group, meron kaming solusyon. And we're now trying to propagate this. Ngayon, ang kagandahan nitong bagong hybrid ni Lalikan, Tony Lalikan, maganda daw for fabric. Kaya ngayon, ginagawa ngayon ng textile at saka yung forest products on the uses of this new abaca virus-resistant hybrid. Not just for cordage, but for pulp and fabric and yarn, textile. Kasi for unang-una, yung pulp, yun ang major use ngayon ng abaca. Yung cordage, konti na lang yun.
Mm-hmm.
So, tamang-tama itong bagong hybrid na ito. But more importantly, yung high-quality yarns and fabrics, yung pwedeng-pwedeng pagyamanin talaga yun na parang export natin for high fashion kind of product. So, malaki ang future ng abaca na kailangan ni bigyan natin ng attention. Pero meron pang ibang fiber, but maybe napag-aralan din namin yun. Pero hindi ko na masyadong kabisado yung mga agave. Hemp. Pero ang aking pananaw ngayon, yung abaca. Push abaca. Kasi ngayon, ang trend ngayon, mga natural fibers.
Ang
tamang-tama yung abaca natin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so,
I'm glad the question was raised about hemp. Meron na nga tayong progress on abaca, and that's one issue we will have to address. It will be a good idea to talk with the administrator ng Fiber Institute.
Filfida.
Let's look more of the potential for this. We tend to focus only on a few crops. But for example, like yung abaca, we produce what? 90% of the abaca in the whole world? And
yes.
Another potential is hemp. We should look more at that. We should coordinate better with the Fiber Institute.
Niche market sana for the Philippines.
Yeah. Maraming potential yan. But I'm glad the question was raised and still raised. We will look at the other possibilities.
Ayan. So para sa mga nag-aabaka dyan, kapit lang sa abaka kasi... Ayan,
baka
gusto nyo pumasok sa pag-aabaka. Yung pala, nandun pala. It's a... I hope that it becomes a sunshine industry, you know. So, together with coconut, na on the way na, abaka.
Yes.
So, I think, grabe yung insight, ang dami nating insights na pick up. Do I speak both for Jim and Justin? Tama ba?
Yes. Absolutely. We started from how Doc Ben and Doc Emil got to where they are.
From wanting to be a general
to a general in agriculture.
and from an industry man to going full circle.
Yeah. Balik scientist. Very, very interesting. Kasi makita natin na naturally, nagpo-progress yung usapan natin from the stories behind. Pumapasok pa rin tayo sa detailed and industry discussion.
Hindi maiwasan.
Hindi maiwasan.
Okay, muna, Dax. Matatapos na tayo, ha?
Opo.
Yes, po.
Allow me to greet your lola, si Soli Solis. Yeah, kababata ko yan sa Santa Cruz.
Ay! Nako, matutuwa yun. Pero sir, naunahan nyo eh. Kasi actually, tradition po namin dito sa show na meron po, kasi bilang Pilipino po tayo, at alam nyo naman po ang mga Pilipino, pag naharap sa TV or naharap sa isang conference, pwede pong, tatanungin po nila lagi, pwede po bang bumate? Pero so meron po tayong corner dito, tawag namin, Batian Corner, or yung mga shout-out na sinasabi namin. So, since nasimulan nyo na, Doc, sige po, you can greet as many people as you like. Give us your parting words as well, your parting shot.
Hindi, ulitin ko yung binabate ko si Soli, kababata ko yan eh.
Okay, sir.
Hey, lola mo. Anyway, sama ko na rin yung mga co-graduates ko sa Guimara sa class of 1956. Si Boy Nancha, si Baby Gasias, si Edith Soriano, si Norma Cavales, mga tagapagsangan. But anyway, let me thank you, Dax, and Jim, and Justin for giving us this opportunity to share stories with your readers and audience. I hope this paved the way for people, young people like you, to think how they can help our country by getting more involved in agriculture. Because there's so much promise, so much opportunity in agriculture in the days to come. Salamat. Thank you.
Okay. My 10 cents word. I want to talk to the young people. We really need to young people to get involved. And I think there's a lot of opportunities. For young people, you can still take risks. And we want you to be involved in not only to make money for yourself, but in nation building. And I think our country is potentially very rich. We're just not being smart enough in how to utilize the resources that our unique country has to offer. We can double our productivity. We're not using our oceans. There's so much potential business. Ang oil, for example, yung onion business ko, I know we import more than half of our onions in the country, and yet I could see during the time that I was there, I could have made a lot more money. So if you don't want to have a boss, consider spending more time on agriculture. Just remember, you have to be there. Importante, yung pinakamalaki input mo is yung bakas mo. But if you are concentrating on it, I think it's possible to make money. Even in tilapia, I have a young friend who is into tilapia. And now he's at the point where he's producing them large enough to nakukuha niya yung fillet. And he exports it under a fancy name and he makes money out of it. But ginagamit niya lahat ng tilapia. Anyway, once you get involved in any particular aspect of agriculture, you learn more and more of it. And then you can potentially grow it. You can succeed. You can be part of the nation building. You can help our country. At the same time, I think the potential is there. You just have to use your brain. By the way, I'll share you something in my onion business. May involved pa ako doon. One reason yung onions, you can keep them only for so long, even in an ice plant. After so many months, they start sprouting. I learned that if you use a certain chemical called maleic hydride, and it's allowed, you spray them 4 days before harvest, hindi na mag-sprout yan because you killed the germinating portion. And you can sell them later. Kasi pag harvest time, mura. By the time you go 3 or 4 months down the line, you can sell them for multiple of what you pay for it. There's a lot of possibilities. Anyway, I hope more young people who are willing to take risks and don't want to have bosses go to agriculture.
So if you're a risk taker and you don't want to have a boss, ayan.
Go to agriculture.
All right. So, sir, Interesting yung chemical na yan, ano? So if I ask another question, baka umabot tayo ng 2.5 hours dito tungkol sa onion. So I just, and maybe I'll shoot you an email about it.
We'll get to know. Copy me in. I want to know about it also.
CC, BCC. So we'll ask you about that chemical. So I'll turn it over to Jim or Justin. Sino mauna?
Si Sir Ben ba? Wala na.
Ay, sir, yes.
Batiin or...
Wala po ba kayong babatiin? Okay na dati.
Yeah, people nga eh.
I think one of your meron po kasi dito gumamit one of your brads is Tilito Oxon also is watching. So yeah. All right. So Justin or Jim, sino muna?
Yes, si Justin muna.
Bart, sandiyan ka pa ba?
Yeah, ako na. Hanggang ngayon overwhelmed pa rin talaga ako with the amount of insights. Hindi ko na alam kung I mean, sana ako magsa-start over with that. Pero talagang generally na-inspire ako. And I hope lahat po na nanood today at yung manonood, by the way, it will be restreamed right later at 7.
7:30.
This show. 7:30. Na ayun, ma-inspire kayo with a story. Ito, a real story from our institutions in the agri industry. Grabe. Hindi ko na alam kung sino mabatiin ko. Basta lahat nanonood to all. Wala na akong masabi.
Sana all.
To my family, to my clan, internal and Dayapan clan in Quezon and Bicol, to MC who is currently working sa Bureau of Soils and Water Management.
Hello.
Si Tita Eva and her family. And of course, sa lahat po ng regular, lahat po ng regular na nanonood. Ayan, sana pag napanood nito ulit later yon, mas makuha niyo yung mga insights. Everything about the sun from their career to the industries, the sky itself by technology and the future of agriculture. Marami talaga kayo matutunan. Yeah, thank you.
Grabe, na-overwhelmed si Barnes. He got choked up, narinig ko.
Bihira yan.
Pero ayun ano, so sobrang dami natin na pag-usapan, hindi na nga natin na pag-usapan yung mga hobbies ni Sir Emil and Doc Ben. I think that could be another discussion for another time.
That's another discussion because I remember Doc Emil inviting me to play tennis kasi nakita niya na lumalaki na daw ako.
Oh!
Sabi niya, Jim, you should join us. Play tennis, ha?
Ayan, tennis na, tennis. And si Doc Ben naman is into I think was it tactical shooting, sir? Tama po ba?
Practical shooting.
So that's another discussion for another day. Baka abutin tayo na 4 hours dito hanggang lunchtime na kikwentuhan tayo. But okay, so Jim, bago ako, ikaw muna, go ahead, bro.
All right. So una sa lahat, Doc Emil, Doc Ben, thank you for your time. Thank you for accepting our invitation. It's an honor for us to have you on our show. We're very happy that you also shared a bit of your life to us and our viewers. Napakalaking bagay po because we value the wisdom that you have built over time in your life experience, and now you're sharing it with us. So I think this in itself is a mentoring for Dax, me, and Justin, and also our viewers. So this is a form of
Absolutely.
Mentoring. And thank you very much for that. Going to, in line with what Doc Emil was saying about history, you know, I'd like to give a huge shout out to my eldest sister, Atsi, because she was the one who sparked my interest in history. Dati ayoko talaga sa mag-aral tungkol sa mga buhay ng mga taong patay na. But then, yung sister ko, when she talked about the French Revolution, and ang nakapag-fascinate sa akin at that time was the guillotine. I was still 6 or 7 years old at that time. But then that sparked my interest in history. And I think that has carried over. So I know my sister is watching this show right now. So a huge shout out to my sister, who also said that she was studying history while Doc Emil was the UP president at that time. So huge shout out to my family, my sisters, huge shout out to my fiance Jewel Macalos, who is, by the way, the daughter of former staff nila ni Doc Emil sa Asia Rice Foundation, si Tita Karina po. So we just got engaged po.
Hindi ko alam yun. Congratulations.
Yes.
Thank you po.
I was there.
Yeah. Kasi
malapit also there. Mga taga Santa Cruz.
si Justin in spirit.
All right. Yeah,
so thank you very much. Thank you po again to Cam and for the benefit of our viewers, you can this recording, if I'm not mistaken, will be streamed again tonight at 7:30 p.m. for those who regularly watch at that time. And Facebook page has also shared this live stream just to share also with the viewers or the followers on the camp webpage. So thank you very much.
Jim, I wrote some of my answers to your questions. Would you want me to email it to you to share in your account?
Sige, sir. Yes.
Sige po, sir.
Yes.
That would be
I wrote out some answers, but some I articulated, some maybe could be of interest to you.
Sure, maybe we can post it on our Facebook and on our website as well as a written piece. Yes, sir. Thank you. And since we're on the subject of history, I'm glad that we are able to do this because this video will be online as long as there's an internet. So, meron at merong makakahanap nito, may makaka-unearth nitong kwentuhan natin ito, and I think they will be able, and they will be appreciative, lalo na kapag napanood nila to at a specific point of time in their lives. And there's a famous quote, those who cannot remember the past are doomed to repeat it. And I think what we have learned from Doc Emil and Doc Ben, we hope not to repeat the bad things, but we want to build on the good things that you have done for this industry and for this country. And we would like to thank you profoundly for joining us today dito sa AgriKaba, sir. Kasi yun nga po, it's not every day you talk to such men of high esteem, and yun nga po, the wealth of experiences that you have is just so vast, and parang feeling ko parang langis ito sa Middle East na ang daming matatap kapag so I hope that after this we can still keep in touch, and also we hope to learn more from you in the upcoming days. Before we go, I would just like to greet my parents, my Papa Joseph and Mama Carol, who my Mama Carol also a UPLB alumna, commented, so proud of Dr. Emil Javier. Santa Cruz Laguna has made a mark in Philippine agriculture because of Dr. Javier and his cousin. okay, and God has blessed the work of your hands and mind. So thank you.
We will carry the baton from Santa Cruz, bro.
Doctor, is it Dr. Bernardo po? Tama ba? Doc Emil is your cousin?
Yes,
Nanding Bernardo.
Fernando Bernardo.
Yes, so ayan, two Santa Cruz kids who made their a national impact, a global impact, and we hope to follow in your lead. And thank you so much. I would like to also to greet my girlfriend Ren, who's in Qatar right now. Please stay safe. And we would like to thank everybody who watched this special edition of AgriKaba. Parang feeling ko next time dapat pang umaga na tong AgriKaba kasi ang daming dami pa lang insight pag yung mga kausap mo, mga morning person.
pag evening na shows, kwela.
Alright. So, in behalf of Dr. Emil Javier and Dr. Ben Pexon of CAMP, in behalf of Jim Cano, Justin Interno,
Wipard,
and Dakila Alfindo, I'm Dakila Alfindo. So, medyo na-overwhelmed pa ako talaga. We would like to thank everybody who watched. We hope you also catch the replay 7:30 p.m. later tonight. So, we want to thank everybody. Have a nice rest of the day, and we'll see you on Monday for our webinar series, Agri 2020, New Perspectives in Agriculture. We will continue our talk on the weather index-based insurance system. And next Wednesday on Agri ka ba? Jim, meron na ba tayong confirmation?
Yes, we have an exciting guest also next week on Agri ka ba? To follow on our first two or current esteemed guests and last week's awesome guest, we have to follow up our agricultural attaché of the Philippines to the UN food agencies in Rome. Wow. So we have Sir Jojo Lupino, no, who will be joining us, the agri attaché to the UN food agencies in Rome, Italy. So yes, tune in next week.
And of course, we also want to send a standing invite to all the camp members na gustong magkwento dito sa Agri ka ba? Sir Ben, Sir Emil, if you can kindly relay to the rest of the camp that kung gusto nilang ikwento or they want to share their insights about agriculture
and their life.
Agri ka ba is a open space for them, sir. Okay, so thank you so much, everybody. We hope to see you later tonight at 7:30 p.m. This has been at ang tanong, Jim, wait lang. Tanong muna.
Sabay-sabay natin sagutin ang tanong next week. Agri ka ba?
Agri ka ba? Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you po, sir.